Hi, everyone. We're here to talk about remote work. It's kind of turned to a reality in the past 2 years. But is it here to stay? I think it's kind of obvious that it's better for many people, but still, as we were talking about, you can't build planes from a distance. So how does that work, remote work and getting talent from wherever in the world, but still having to do stuff in place? How does it work? How do you balance that?
Yeah, absolutely. So we have a marketplace for mechanical and electrical engineers. So we are working with companies that build physical things. So consumer electronics, planes, boats, cars, battery management systems. So it really rocked our industry because our industry also in electrification is building a lot of first generation products. So it wasn't as easy for them to just be like, oh, we can go and code at home. And so it made it incredibly complicated for them. And they learned how to work remote, but they still very much needed to go back to the office. And so and they were also essential workers in the US. So they were some of the first people back in the office. But I think you can't unring a bell. And now they kind of got a taste of what it was like working remote. So now we're seeing all these folks that they don't necessarily want to be in the office.
Yeah, most of them don't want to be in the office.
Not 5 days a week anymore. Yeah,
but there's a lot of companies have chosen to have mixed ways of working. So half the week they're home and half the week they're at the office. Is that better to exchange ideas, to have brainstormings? Is that the better way, Jeremy?
It's tough. You need some in-person time. Like great companies need to build great culture. Great culture requires trust, and trust is just easier to build when you have some time in person. But at the same time, no one actually wants to commute 5 days a week. Actually, statistically, virtually no one actually wants to do it.
Especially because the cities have moved far away from our homes. And
completely,
you work and you
completely.
Go to home and you'll lose like an hour a day.
That's exactly right. It's completely unproductive. And so what's going to happen is you're going to see like gravity pulling the world more and more towards remote. As Kim said, as people have gotten a taste for it, they really don't want to go back, which means great companies will have to find other ways to help build camaraderie and trust between teams. And that will require getting together in person. I think that you're going to see a far larger percentage of companies long-term staying fully remote, but investing much more in travel to bring people together periodically throughout the year, if that's possible. If you're, you know, building airplanes, that's a little bit more complicated.
Yeah,
but if you're building software, and that's what Andela primarily supports, it's a global marketplace for software engineers in almost 100 countries around the world now. Most of those engineers are going to stay remote, but spend more time connecting, like, once a quarter with teams from around the world who are coming together to build relationships more than software in those moments.
Mm-hmm. Still, even if you're building airplanes, you have to have this tech and innovative roots. So there's that part that you can work in remote workplaces. Is it important to get people together with the ones that are on the job, hands-on?
Oh, absolutely. And I think a lot of our customers, they're building things like autonomous drones, electric boats. They're building first generations of products that need to be manufactured. So it's really critical that they're there. And they're not necessarily set up to do that remote. But also, you know, they're being challenged by a lot of the FANG companies and Facebook and Google that are all, you know, obviously building their own hardware products, building robotics. And they're heavily remote. So now they have also this new competition that they're struggling to compete with because they're able to offer remote. They're at a different type of scale, a different cycle of the product.
Yeah, because what this brought is that you can recruit all over the world. You can have an engineer in Spain and then have another techie in, I don't know, Guatemala. And they're all working together and everyone's
completely
competing for the same talent. Has it brought more difficulties than got things easier?
So for most companies, the answer is yes, it creates complications, but you can't ignore it. And so companies have to figure out what they're going to do in response. And I think that's actually part of why Kim and my businesses have been exploding over the past year. People look at global talent pools and say, where do I go? Who do I talk to? And then how do I deal with logistics once I get there around things like payroll and compliance, just the complexity of managing global teams. And so the genie is not going back in the bottle. People are going to continue needing to think about the world as a hiring pool, but that also both opens up opportunities, much broader talent, much more efficient access to like what could be amazing team members, but also complexity in just how you manage that, how you source, how you assess, and then help how you manage that talent gets much harder. And so I think you're going to see over the next 5 years a dramatic shift towards talent networks as a means for hiring not just part-time work, but full-time talent across the entire labor spectrum. And hiring is going to look very different 5 years from now because of that combination.
And how do you interview someone? You're getting someone new into the team. You know they're technically good, but you still want to meet them. You still want to look them in the eye and see how the body language works. How do you do that online?
We don't actually. So we made a choice. We're remote, but we actually, our team gets together once a week in Los Angeles. So we've made a point to hire everyone in California or shooting for Southern California, and we meet them on site. And I actually think there isn't a right or wrong answer. It's not that everything is going to be fully remote or everything should be, you know, in the office 40 hours a week. What we're really seeing is, it's about what's right for you as a person. So I think it's about how do we adapt to the unique needs of people. Some people are home with kids and it's difficult for them to work there. Some people have roommates and they hate working at home. And so I think it's important to just be flexible and to be adaptable and know that there isn't one right answer, but also create an environment where you're attracting the type of people that want to work, like want to work at a company where you see your colleagues. Like one of the things we've done is we've focused on people that did want an in-person component. So we're very explicit about that. So the right people opt in and they're excited about being in that environment and they don't feel like they're forced to be there. Mm-hmm.
There used to be a time where having a flippers machine at the office or something was something that attracted people to work in that environment. Is nowadays that attraction, does that come from being able to work anywhere in the world, like I choose to work in Portugal, but I'm working for an American company? Is that a factor?
I think it's connected to Kim's point there about people choosing things that are right for them. I think, again, that's part of why talent networks are going to explode over the next 5 years, because every company now needs to think more holistically, but specifically about who they want to be, and therefore who their culture will be. In a world where everyone is going to an office, a foosball table might be a differentiator. Like that at one point was literally a differentiator. In a world where that's not a requirement, you have to think as a company, who do you want to be and how do you want to show up? Because that will then impact who you attract from a talent standpoint. And who you attract will define then what you're able to build. And so I think that there's just an additional layer of specificity and thought that companies need to put into who they want to be that will then impact who is attracted. And it's okay that not everyone wants to work at every company. That's how many, especially large companies, FAN companies, feel like they need to attract as many people as possible and that there's some generic like norm. The reality, and this is especially true for startups, is that most people are not going to be a good fit, and that's okay. The goal is not to be like attractive to everyone, but rather to find the right fit for you. And talent networks using many, many more data points will be better able to do that than most talent acquisition teams for small companies.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that this new remote ways of working have shifted the way that we recruit? Like it's not the companies that look for people, it's people that look for companies?
It's definitely reset the relationship between employers and employees. Employees have a tremendous amount of power right now. They have a lot of choice. They have 10 times more companies they can apply to. This also is creating a lot of chaos and a lot of friction because you're now getting 10 times, you know, more applicants. And so I think that's why networks like ours are emerging. And we're seeing a lot of them in the US. You know, there's one for oil rig workers, nurses, teachers, one for doctors called Doximity that just, you know, went public for, you know, more than $18 billion. And so I think now what people actually want is they don't actually want more options. They want less options and a better choosing experience to find the right type of company that they're going to be successful in. So I think from an employer perspective, we just have to do a better job of selling what we're about. One of the big problems I see is people want to throw money at the problem and bigger salaries.
It's not a factor anymore,
is it? Bigger salaries help, but if it's just about salary for someone, they'll always just leave for more money. So you need to find people that are intrinsically motivated to like work on your company, your project, your values, your subject matter.
So remote has thrown people apart, but still they're becoming closer together to a project, because otherwise they're not interested in working in a company. Is that connectivity an increasingly important issue?
Absolutely. And again, it just goes to specificity and companies needing to know themselves, what they care about, why they care about that, like what they stand for in the world, and how the world will be different as a result of their actions and the actions of their entire team. And you could get away with a lot less in a world where companies were more generic and everyone was going into an office. We're now operating in a world where you really can't. You need to be able to connect into who you are and what you care about, or your team won't be able to, your company won't be able to, and you won't end up attracting people that really do care and are there to build long term. I think it's a wonderful thing that people have more choices now. It's a fantastic thing for the world, and it will make things harder for companies. On the other side, it also creates a whole bunch of new opportunities for companies. So those that move quickly and embrace how the world is changing. And as Kim said, it's not just one right way, but embrace like the multitude of different ways that one can succeed. It's the best time ever to be building companies.
And still, you're not going to choose a job and do that job for the whole of your life. So does it increase that kind of possibilities to do something today and just tomorrow I'm interested in a different, all different things, and I'm applying to new companies, and I can study and work and have different experiences. Is that easier in remote?
I think it depends on the person. I think there's no one size fits all. That, you know, I don't expect. I'd love for people to stay for their whole career, but I don't think that's like realistic anymore. But I think right now there's a choice that people, you know, are making, which is, do I want to be a freelancer? Do I want, you know, or do I want the stability of a full-time job in the U.S., which comes with healthcare, which is a very important consideration for folks. So it's not. You know, it just, short answer is it depends.
It depends on who you are and what your goals are, and probably your age. Do you think that older people are as adapted as younger people to these new ways of doing things?
I think they like it more. I think, you know, in particular, what we saw is obviously our some of our older employees or folks that have kids, like, you know, they really enjoyed being at home, not having the commute. Their life is still complicated, you know, working with child, dealing with childcare, but also it was much simpler taking that away, where, you know, our younger employees actually, that's where they make their friends. It's like a big part of their social life. They didn't necessarily weren't excited to be, you know, if you're 24 and that's how you're building your network and you're getting to know your colleagues.
Yeah, you don't want to be home alone.
They don't want to be at home. Their apartments aren't that big. They're working in their bedroom. It's loud. So I was pleasantly surprised to see a lot of the younger folks requesting an office. So for us, we just tell people, we're going to be flexible. There's an office. If you want it, it's there. You can go to it.
Do you have the same experience?
Yeah, I think it's exactly right. Like, it's in some ways better and worse for both groups. I think younger people love the freedom to travel and to be a little bit like more like open-minded about how they can choose to work. But it's true that if you're in your mid-20s, your office historically has been a major part of your social life. So that creates challenges. On the other hand, it's harder to adapt if you've spent 30 years in the working world already and now you've got to go remote. That's a very different environment. But you probably appreciate that ability to like be more with your family, for instance, in ways that you wouldn't if you were younger. And so it's better and worse for both. But the data is very clear that even though there are pros and cons, almost no one actually wants to go back to the office 5 days a week. And so like that is just true. And so you're going to see a lot of hybrid approaches for the people that do want to be in an office environment. And there will be companies that differentiate by having something of an office environment in the same way that historically it was really like atypical to have entirely remote options. And that was a way to differentiate. Now the picture is just much more diverse.
It's broader too.
Yeah.
And how do you retain the talent very, very quickly, because we're running out of time, but how do you retain talent if you're miles away from those people that work for you?
You know, I think this goes back to, you know, what I was mentioning about having intrinsic motivation. So we really seek out people that care about what we do. They care about HR tech. They care about marketplaces. They want to gain a competency. It's something we're going to be able to deliver them something in their career that's valuable, and that's what's going to keep them there. And this is where you can't just throw money at it. They'll just leave. They'll leave, you know, in 6 months for someone that pays them more money. So I really look for people that are just excited to learn about what we do and for us to help them, you know, accelerate their career.
Okay, do you agree,
yeah.
Jeremy?
I do, and I agree fully, and I would look at this through the lens of, like, what are you focused on? I think many companies mess this up by focusing on why would someone leave, as opposed to how do they make themselves a place where the right kind of people are excited to be? Like, how do you be the best version of yourself as a company? I think that focus on who do you want to be and how do you do that excellently is like the right mindset for companies. It's really easy to go in the other direction, but it's much more productive to focus on greatness.
Yeah, and just stay connected. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Jeremy. Thank you, Kim.
Thank you, guys.
Bye. Thank you. Have a nice day.